Are you on a new vibration, building your own foundation? Then welcome to Vibration Cinema, the alter destiny of film. And yes, Beyonce is a Varb, confirmed. She checks up on me every now and then. To close out Pride Month, we're going to look at the holy trinity of black queer filmmakers and the remixing of history and creative uses of the archive. Much of our official history as black people were written by those who enslaved us, and our history as LGBT people is stored in the closet. The filmmakers we're discussing in this video challenge the archive and invent histories to fill in the gaps.
I'm just saying I hate history, period, because I don't like studying things that people did before. You know, it's just all about what's going on now. People got to do now. They can't keep looking back on stuff that happened a long time ago.
See, to me, history is important because you have to look back. History repeats itself. You know, maybe you can look back on something that happened a long time ago, and it could help you out now.
Chains tied on your ankles and stuff, they ain't gonna help you. Better try to learn that IBM computer or something. On the real, for real, you know.
Marlon Riggs was a powerhouse director who used the archive from the very beginning of his career. He started off work in local television in the late 70s before studying documentary filmmaking at UC Berkeley, where he wrote and produced his thesis film, Long Train Running, The History of Oakland Blues. I know he worked in public access TV production after graduating, but I can't track down any early credits. But public access television was a major production and distribution outlet for the AIDS video activists, so we're going to loop back to Riggs' work in that context in a couple of months. But relevant here is how Riggs uses the archive to remix history. Long Train Running is fairly standard in its use of material, mostly as evidence and information. But with his Emmy award-winning 1986 documentary Ethnic Notions, Riggs begins to use the archive argumentatively, weaving memorabilia, books, footage, art, and music, and cartoons to show how race is created, blackness is commodified and consumed, how that plays out in politics, and the feedback loop it creates. The clips and sounds are not there to supplement the statements of the talking heads, rather the archive is the driving force and the talking heads give the context. The 1992 color adjustment, a quasi-sequel to Notions, builds on a lot of the techniques of its predecessor, though it focuses on how television specifically fits into that feedback loop. Riggs uses his personal history in Tongues Untied as a microcosm to explicate a broader point of black gay politics in the time of AIDS. Tongues is made up of bits and sketches. Racial slurs respond to Riggs' call as he recounts his childhood. A montage of milky men animates his desires and fears. And a Snapology tutorial arms the audience with an offensive mechanism against microaggressions. But importantly, Tongues is not just Marlon's story. Joseph Beam co-wrote it and interpolates some of his writing for the film, including the iconic call to action that black men, loving black men, is the revolutionary act. The Lavender Lovelights perform throughout the film, the incisive and urgent poetry of X's Hymnful structures the film, etc. Marlon's last film, Black Is, Black Ain't, is the culmination of his life's work, using the personal video diary method from Tongues and mixing it with his inclination to repurpose the archive from Notions and Adjustment. In a way, this film is Marlon's deathbed confession. He passed while in the middle of making it. In this film, Grandma Riggs' gumbo recipe becomes a stand-in for the many flavors and textures of blackness. Riggs' work is so piercing with how he cuts the official archive against itself, but the true genius of his work is in how he situates the personal archive, the unofficial archive, in his understanding of blackness. The invention of the mammy and the minstrel are not holistic or useful definitions of blackness, and as ubiquitous as these stereotypical images may be, they are not, in fact, official. We define ourselves in our art and videos and songs and stories and poems and gumbo. Looking for Langston is a poetic meditation on queer Harlem Renaissance, but the film was conceived when Isaac attended James Baldwin's memorial service. Toni Morrison's eulogy for Jimmy actually opens the film.
When that unassailable combination of mind and heart, of intellect and passion, was on display, it guided us through treacherous landscape, as it did when you wrote these words, words every rebel, every dissident, every revolutionary, every practicing artist, from Cape Town to Poland, from Waycross to Dublin, could memorize. A person does not lightly elect to oppose his society. One would much rather be at home among one's compatriots than be mocked and detested by them?
When the film was released, both the Baldwin and Hughes estate censored the film in various ways.
So both the prologue and the epilogue of the work had the sound turned down because the Hughes estate was threatening to take the Lincoln Society to court on the basis of it being a copyright infringement. What had happened or transpired was on my flight from London to New York, we thought we had a certain amount of fair use copyright claim on the work, but we realized that this poem that begins with Hughes at the beginning and ends the film constitutes a whole poem, and so therefore they kind of, you know, were threatening
In Undressing Icons, a critique of George Bass, executor of the Hughes estate, Essex Hemphill asks, who has access to black history? Who is allowed to examine it and interpret it? Who decides what can and cannot be discussed? Langston visualizes the open secret of Hughes's homosexuality and reminded people of Baldwin's. Baldwin spoke openly about his sexuality, but his estate, even 2 years after his passing, is trying its damnedest to suppress any reference to it. So what the film does is debunk the official history, both estates' fabrications, by cinematically rendering the actual history. So much of gay culture and history is stuck in the closet. Historically, we've hidden ourselves out of caution, and that makes it easier to disappear us officially. In a certain sense, we don't exist. A vein of politics exists to keep it that way. On May 6, 1933, the Nazis stormed the Institute of Sexology and burned 14 years worth of study and advocacy for LGBT rights. And we see the historical echo of this as conservatives try to storm libraries where drag queens are reading to kids to ban any reference to LGBT people from schools, books, and the media. Both estates, though not as forthcomingly, take part in that violence. The film doesn't indict the estates, which it probably couldn't and still screen, but it nevertheless destabilizes their control over both men's lives and legacies. This is all more or less known about the film, but the film also inadvertently is a historical artifact in a challenge against Robert Mapplethorpe's Black Book. Deep Dish Television produced a video about the right-wing attempts to censor the exhibit on the grounds of decency and children. In the video, LGBT free speech warriors wax poetics about artistic integrity and whatever the fuck. Nobody in the video is black. And there was a lot of uproar by black gay men over this series. Most famously is Glenn Ligon's Notes on the Margins of the Black Book, where he takes the sequence of photographs and puts critiques of the exhibit itself and of other cultural writing about blackness underneath them. But there is a scene in Langston where the white slummer walks through the images from the Black Book as if he's hunting for the night's BBC. Again, the scene isn't very agitating, but it is clear enough in that it evokes the double white gaze. How Mapplethorpe sees black people and how this man finds eroticism in that, and the sexual predation that that entails. He doesn't even interact with the actual photos, but merely projections of them. This man only sees black men as a shadow of a shadow. And when he does interact with actual black men, it's to remind his flirtatious bull that it is owned and cannot desire another black man. In this way, the film is a part of the critical history of Mapplethorpe's work. We've talked on this channel before about the malleability of space and time in film, and Langston is very playful with the historical times. What could easily pass as a stand-in for the Cotton Club in the 1920s, blasts house music, archival footage is cut against what Isaac shot to match, stories and poems from Fire magazine from 1926 are cut against the poems and stories written by Essex Hemphill in the academic work of Stuart Hall from the 1980s. A Barthian visual pun links Isaac's fabricated funeral to Baldwin's memorial. Time isn't necessarily cyclical here. History doesn't repeat itself. Instead, time is more akin to brackish water.
The past and the future merge to meet us here.
All of this and so much more is very well paced, organized, and articulated in a mere 45 minutes. It's actually a miracle of filmmaking. Faye Richards was an old Hollywood actress playing mammy characters in the 1930s and relaunching her career as a star in race cast pictures before they fell out in the late 1930s. Faye was a singer, a Philly legend, and a lesbian. The Watermelon Woman is a documentary about director Cheryl Dunnie's attempts to unearth the true story of Faye Richards. Faye, of course, is not real. She never existed. The Watermelon Woman supposes that Faye did exist. Her name might not have been Faye, but surely one black Hollywood actress had to be in the life. The movie invents that history, literally. Zoe Leonard produced all of the photos and footages and memorabilia of Faye for the movie. In Venus in Two Acts, Sadia Hartman, demonstrates her historical methodology, critical fabulation, which fills in the gaps left by the historical record, imagining the inner lives of slaves who obviously could not create a historical record.
One of the chapters of Lose Your Mother that's described the dead book, I describe the experience of a young enslaved girl aboard a slave ship. The only thing said about the girl in the trial were four words, the said Negro girl. And I thought, how do I begin to tell her story? How can I reconstruct the terms of her experience aboard the slave ship? I utilize the various versions of the legal case, as well as newspaper accounts, to tell the story from a range of perspectives. Critical fabulation was central to being able to resurrect forgotten history, lost lives, the millions of stories that were lost in the Middle Passage.
Hartman takes the historical record and builds atop it. Dunye takes it a step further by straight up inventing historical records. And it's more than just the photos and home videos of Richards and the movies that she starred in. Dunye creates an urban legend. On the street interviews reveal that, yeah, I think I might have heard of her. Or, oh yeah, that's my mama's cousin.
Isn't she the lady that wore the fruit cocktail on her head?
No, that's Rosie Perez, Buka.
Well, that could have been her alias name.
Oh, child, I don't think
she wore the fruit cocktail with the leaves
Is that answer?
No.
Avocados and things?
Isn't that Rosie?
It was not Rosie. This lady was back in the 40s and 50s.
Oh, well, it could have been Rosie. She looked like she was in the 40s and 50s.
Oh, Rosie's gonna kill you.
Cheryl's archive includes gossip and conjecture. Of course, official sources like Camille Paglia,
I never heard of her,
can't imagine there being such a scandalous sapphic history between a white director and a black actress. And the Fictional Institute, and hopefully the YouTube algorithm will forgive this, the Center for Lesbian Information and Technology, a very white institution, tries to keep Dunye from recording the materials on Faye, recalling Essex's earlier questions about the gatekeeping of history. But it's at this archive that leads Cheryl to June Walker's, Faye's real lover. Unfortunately, June is hospitalized before Cheryl can interview her, adding to the sense of urgency and the transience of this fabulated history. The film ends with a simple title card that reads, "Sometimes you have to create your own history." Much of our history, our actual history, as Black LGBT people, is passed hand to hand. If the official record isn't missing, then it might as well have been itself a creation, as Marlon demonstrates, one that confirms the assumption of white supremacy. So we might as well get in there and make some shit up too. That's all for today. I put a link to some readings relevant to the episode in the description below, and MoMA might still be screening Looking for Langston for free, so I'll have a link to that. By the time this video is published, who knows though. But next up, we're tackling gaze theory in the next installment of our channel series, Eyes and Teeth. Look forward to that. In the meantime, happy pride, like, comment, share, subscribe. Love you all madly, bye.